Stop studying. What you're doing right now might be a waste of time. Read over your notes. Review the class material. Highlight things. Repetition, repetition, repetition. These study tactics have been drilled into you for years. But the science is very clear. Certain study techniques are more beneficial than others. So instead of you spending hours and hours trying to search for the right answer, I've done the work for you. And in today's video, you're going to develop a significant advantage over the rest of your class, your friends, and your peers. You're going to learn the 5 best techniques for studying effectively in less time than anyone else. Now, if you want this to sink in and you want to be a master student, is while you watch, you're going to take action immediately. And this video is the first in a free 5-part video course on becoming the most remarkable student that you can be. And Motivation to Study and I, we want this information to be available to anyone, anywhere, at no cost. Because we believe you shouldn't have to pay for this. It should have been taught to you in your school, in your lesson. And since it wasn't, we got you covered. We're giving this all away for free, so just make sure you subscribe to both of our channels and you ring the bell icon so you know when new lessons are released. Let's get into it. Did you know there are people out there so good at remembering things that they compete in tournaments of learning and they are known as memory athletes? In an annual contest called the World Memory Championships, they were given 20 minutes to remember a list of 72 random words. And on average, they scored nearly 71 of the 72. By contrast, an untrained control group could only manage 26. Another example, Akira Haraguchi. At 69 years old, much older than most of you listening, in 2006, recited 111,700 digits of pi from memory at a public event near Tokyo. For 16 hours, he kept going and going and going. Imagine the power of having a memory like that. And starting today, I want you to imagine yourself as one of them. You're not just a student or a teenager or a grad, but you are a memory athlete. You're going to become someone with such power over your mind that you can recall pages of notes, equations, formulas that you need without the endless hours of beating information into your head. But how? Do you need an innate gift? Can you learn it? Well, actually, you already have. Picture where the spoons are kept in your kitchen, the socks in your room, the color of your toothbrush. These memory athletes use an ancient Greek technique called memory palaces. And once you master this technique, you too are going to dramatically improve your ability to study effectively and finally open up your dormant reserves of memory. The idea is simple. You walk through an environment like your house and you place objects in specific places. And then you match the things you want to learn with those objects. So when you're trying to remember that information, perhaps the notes you took that day in class, you don't just think back to your notes. You think of where those notes are in your house. Which object did you attach it to? What's the color? And you reapply this until it becomes crystal clear in your mind. This technique maps new information onto something that your brain has already evolved to do extremely well. Recall imagery in specific locations. The second technique. For thousands of years, people have known that the best way to understand a concept, explain it to someone else. The second technique I want to introduce you to is also known as the protege effect, aka teach someone what you want to learn. A 2007 study looked at this. How does teaching someone impact your learning? Students in this study, who were also teachers to younger students, they scored higher on tests than pupils who were learning only for their own sake. Why? Well, the researchers found when you choose to teach someone else, you have to work harder to understand the material, to recall it more accurately and apply it more effectively, something known as depth of processing. Physicist Robert Feynman created a mental model called the Feynman technique. Now, some of you may have already seen videos about this on YouTube. This technique has four steps to it. Number one, write the name of a concept on the top of a blank page that you want to learn. Number two, write down an explanation of the concept as if you're teaching a new student. Number three, identify what's missing. Go back, relearn. And step four, review everything. Make sure you're avoiding using complicated language and try to simplify everything on the page as much as possible. Now, this technique, it forces you to deconstruct and then reconstruct ideas. To use this method and learn how to study effectively, identify first, what do you want to learn? And then try to imagine you're explaining it to a five-year-old. Number three, master students are committed to effective study strategies, but shipwrecked students are committed to ineffective study strategies. If I asked you right now, is reading again and again a good way to learn? Is highlighting a good way to learn? Is using keyword mnemonics? Well, all of these, they're scientifically proven to be relatively low in effectiveness for long-term learning. At the other end of the scale, things like practice tests, spreading out your learning, they are scientifically proven to boost your performance. Let's take a look. In 2005, a guy called Reagan A.R. Gurung assessed 229 students using 11 different techniques of studying. He then matched their techniques with their final exam scores. And many, but not all, of the techniques they used, they did achieve better exam scores. For example, the number of hours they put in, it did help. But things like starting studying early or reading material before and after class, that didn't seem to be effective. Reagan also found detriments to studying, and one of them was listening to music. So what did he find that does work? Well, Reagan actually found a technique that strongly predicted your exam score. And that was the number of times a student did practice tests. This one thing, above all others, had a significant impact on how well they did on their final exam. He even found that rewriting notes, reviewing highlighted material, it didn't really impact the final exam score that much. So like I said, master students are committed to effective study strategies, but shipwrecked students are committed to ineffective study strategies. And if you want to know which type of student you are, click on the link in the description and take the quiz to find out if you're a master, a dabbler, or a shipwreck castaway when it comes to your study. Not all hustle is created equal. Have you ever heard of number four, the Zeigarnik effect? It's a concept in psychology that argues you remember uncompleted or interrupted tasks better than the ones that you complete. Why? When we start a task and then interrupt it, it creates a task-specific tension that can improve your cognitive function. So step away from your desk as you study. That tiny little tension that you feel, I still need to finish reviewing that chapter. I haven't done the next paper yet. It keeps the task at the top of your mind, and this keeps your brain focused on it. This way you can easily access that information and remember it better. So how do you take advantage of this technique? You take frequent breaks during your deep work. The Zeigarnik effect suggests that students who take breaks during which they perform totally unrelated activities, studying other subjects, reading a book, going on a 3-minute walk, playing the piano, they remember material better than students who go through longer study sessions without taking a break. A popular way that I'm sure most of you have heard of is the Pomodoro technique, where you work for 25 minutes, you take a 5-minute break. You work for 25 minutes, you take a 5-minute break. And the final tip of this first lesson in our course, cramming is better than not studying in the short term. But is 7 hours in one day better than 1 hour every day for a week? If you were given the same amount of time for study, would you be better off spreading it out? And the answer is a resounding yes. Space it out. This is known as distributed practice. Distributing learning over time, either in a single study session or across study sessions, it benefits long-term retention more than massive cramming and learning back to back. Space your study out. And how general are the effects? How consistent? Well, one group of scientists looked at 254 studies involving over 14,000 people, and overall, students recalled more after spaced study than after cramming and massed study. So look, at the end of the day, you have to do what works for you. Having family and friends around, replying to your messages on your smartphone, missing class, having the TV on, that's not going to help you. But doing practice tests, getting to sleep on time, eating the proper nutrition, exercising, explaining what you've learned to others, using these techniques, they are going to help. So you know what the techniques are. You have to prepare effectively. You have to focus on the right things effectively. And most of all, you have to take action every single day. Hope you guys enjoyed this video. Make sure you subscribe, and I'll see you in the next lesson of the series. Peace.